you to spend over this stuff?
Yes, I did, but I'm a terrible liar.
You know, Jeff, something about this is like you're given the feeling of being in a cathedral.
Well, if we were, I'd know where the exit was.
Hey, you don't believe in anything, do you?
Of course I do.
Oh, really? What? Things I can touch, taste,
see, hear, smell, and swallow.
I envy you, Jeff. That's the dumbest thing I've ever heard, Tommy. You've got yourself a fine job.
You're engaged to a fine woman, and you're lost in a fine country. Now, what more could you ask for?
I don't know. Something's wrong. Especially about Jane and me. But look how I postpone getting married. I just can't get myself to that altar.
Well, I don't know what could be wrong about it. She's young, attractive, fits right into your niche in life.
And what's more, she loves you. And just the proper amount, too.
And what's the proper amount?
Enough to make you happy and not enough to embarrass your friends.
Seems ideal, huh? Why don't I see you? I'll be lacking somewhere.
Now look, don't start putting yourself down. You don't deserve it.
What do you mean?
Well, Tommy, most people who put themselves down are absolutely right. They're not as good as everybody else.
Someone like you who's constant.
Everywhere, don't you know? can get going.
Well, that's enough, Eddie.
Make a profit doing that.
No, but I make a lot of friends.
Agnes, do you see this?
Grateful I am for
was that you said about postponing a miracle?
Tis a toast we have here.
Aye, tis a toast.
A toast.
Aye.
From now on, tis for sale.
I must buy some claret and ale for the supper. If you come with me, you can have some more.
Fine. He's an odd lad, isn't he? Really peculiar actor. I wonder what American women must be like.
Oh, I don't wonder about women anymore, Agnes. I'm not allowed.
But it's great fun. Look through the last of the good and the time. The team are all the dark.
done and that'll be over.
Charlie, what are you going to do all day?
Rest, baby. Rest! Hey, he's a nice lad.
Why? He is that.
It's really refreshing to see a fellow so enthusiastic about getting married.
That's so unusual.
Well, I think it is. Well, look at me. I'm not bubbling over like Charlie. Next month I'm facing an instrument.
You're getting married?
Yes.
Oh,
what?
I'm very surprised. Somehow you didn't look like the sort of lad who wants to settle down.
I didn't say that. Just said I was getting married.
Well, if you feel that way about it, why are you?
Because she wants to.
Is that reason enough?
I guess so.
Well, I must say, it didn't sound like you love her very much.
It does, it does.
It also sounds very peculiar.
Well, talking of peculiar, what was that business about Charlie and the man who postponed the miracle?
I'm sorry, I cannot say.
You said you'd tell me later.
I know, but I cannot say.
That's fine. You know, if I stick around this place a little longer, I'll probably discover that everybody is nutty. Is that possible?
I cannot say.
Why not?
Because I didn't know what nutty means.
Being slightly insane.
Do
that.
On the hill where it grows.
Yeah, go.
It's a very picturesque view of the glen.
Thank you.
For what?
Why, for liking what I'm watching. Makes me very happy.
You get happy very easily, don't you?
I...
You know, I haven't seen an open shed like that since I was a kid, which at this point seems a good 2,000 years ago.
Don't tell me you're tired.
Aye, lassie, I'm tired. That is why you brought me up here, isn't it? So that I could take a nap?
I shouldn't think a long walk would fatigue a young lad.
A young lad.
Aye, you're very young.
Now that is either a deliberate lie or wishful thinking. I am ancient, decrepit, and disintegrating rapidly.
Aye.
What's under here, a rock garden?
My father used to sleep on it. He and my mother met in this shed. You see, my mother was a gypsy. Then one day, she was walking past the shed, and she saw my father asleep on the cot. She liked his looks, and she was a wee bit tired anyhow. So, she took off her shoes, sat on this rock, and waited for him to wake up. And very soon after that, I was born.
That's one of the sweetest bedtime stories I've ever heard.
You're sure you're comfortable?
Very. Thank you very much. You've been more than kind. And now if you want to round out your generosity, buzz off.
You're a poor and handsome lad.
You should see me when I'm rested. I'm almost robust.
I just came to leave you.
Well, you better. You see, when I sleep, I make all sorts of odd noises.
Oh, you're a winning lad. Nice winning lad.
Now look, lass. I'm not sure what it is that you're after, but I don't want to. I just want to go to sleep.
But didn't you see?
Thank you very much. When I wake up, we'll discuss the problem. And believe me, you've got a problem.
And when I look at you, I feel tadpoles jumping on my spine.
You know, if sex were a hobby, you'd be a collector's item.
But I've been waiting so long.
No!
Oh! You men are all alike.
I should certainly hope so.
You're all brutes. You get what you want from the last, and then here's farewell.
Get what I want? I can't even get you to go away.
That is what I am referring to. I thought you were interested in me, and that's why you let me take you here. You misled me.
You certainly have one hell of an imagination. Can you give me one good reason why I, a strange man, should be interested in you, a strange woman, and at this hour of the day?
Of course I can. Because you're a lad, and I'm a lass.
With that philosophy, you must have had a provocative career.
I've had a great many heartbreaks.
I don't count it at all.
Thank you.
Cause they fall at me, I can't be all of thee. They're when music sparks play. Ease my longing, there's not the wrong in this study of the
thank you.
Fiona?
Aye.
Nothing.
Morning, Letty!
Okay, you know
know Jean's getting married today, don't you?
Doesn't everybody?
The name of the guy she's marrying is Charlie Dalrymple. Fiona told him to come over and to sign the family Bible, and it seems he's done just that. Married Jean MacLaren to Charles McPherson Dalrymple, May 24th, which happens to be today,
okay.
1780. And that, my friend, is the last entry. Now what do you say?
I told you we shouldn't have come. The only safe place in the world today is New York City.
No Brigadoon on the map. No phones in the whole town. I don't understand it. Beginning to feel like a damn fool. Ah, there must be a logical explanation for all of this. Let's start all over again. Mary. Jean MacLaren.
To Charles McPherson Dalrymple. May 24, 1780.
You're
the
people of that
life? Aye, we are.
That's
impossible. No,
lad. She's a miracle. Aye. There you are, Tommy. One logical explanation.
Sorry, but I can't tell you.
Is there anybody who can? I want to know.
You'll have to speak with the Dominie.
I need
the
Dominie.
The who?
Our schoolmaster, Mr. Lundy.
Where is he there?
Down the road in the tree.
He doesn't live in a tree, Mr. Dublin. Mr. Lundy is a great man.
Because what happened in Brigadoon was a miracle. and look hope in a relief. Miracles read by faith, and faith seems to be as dead as...
Mr. Forsage?
Aye. Now, this miracle happened exactly 200 years ago. 200 years ago, the Highlands of Scotland were plagued with witches. Wicked sorcerers who were taking the Scottish folk away from the teachings of God and putting a devil into their souls. They were horrible, destructive creatures. Now, here in Brigadoon, we had an old minister named Mr. Forsyth.
The kindest man in Scotland.
No man ever loved his parish as did Mr. Forsyth. He was growing old. And it grieved him to think that one day soon he would leave all those that did. Most of all, he worried about the witches and Brigadoon. He began to wonder. There wasn't something he could do. Protect the folk of his parish, not only from them. All the evils that might come from Brigadoon from the outside world after he died. He spent many days walking through the glen, thinking. Then one day, came to me, told me he had decided to ask God for a miracle. He consulted with me about it, because he knew I have a highly logical mind. Not as long as he was going to ask for a miracle, it might as well be a well-organized miracle. For many days I wandered through the glen with him. Many nights I sat with him by candlelight. Finally, Mr. Poseidon decided what he was going to pray for. On an early Wednesday morning, right after this hour, the sight went out to a hill beyond Brigadoon and made his prayer to God. There in the hush of the sleeping world, he asked God that night to make Brigadoon all the people in it vanish into the Highland mist. Each morning, when they awaken, it would be 100 years late. When we awoke, the next morning, it was 100 years later. Change in the lives of the people. They just wouldn't stay in any century long enough to be injured by it.
You mean if you go to bed at night, and when you wake up the next morning, 100 years later?
Aye.
Every day is 100 years later?
Aye.
Well, what happened to the minister?
Never saw him again. You see, he realized that to ask for such a miracle, some sacrifice would have to be made, and he wanted to be the one to make it. That's why he went to a hill beyond Brigadoon, where the miracle granted, he would never see Brigadoon again.
And all this happened 200 years ago.
Which you see is only 2 days ago. to us.
Let me ask you something. Suppose somebody around here wants to leave. Then what?
He cannot. Wait a minute. You mean we gotta stay here now?
No. But according to Mr. Forsythe, she comes back with God. If anyone of Brigadoon leaves, the enchantment is broken for all.
Yes.
And that night, when the people go to sleep, Brigadoon will disappear forever.
Look, I'm not saying I believe all this, but just for argument's sake, let's just suppose that a stranger like me happened to come to Brigadoon and he wanted to stay. Could he?
I would. He could. Mr. Forsythe provided for that.
He didn't miss a trick, did he?
No, laddie, he didn't.
A stranger can stay if he loves someone here. Someone of Brigadoon, enough to want to give up everything and stay with that one cut.
That's how it should be. After all that, when you love someone deeply, anything is possible.
I think I like that part the best.
Surely you've been thinking about changing for the weapon.
villages this would be in the land of the state. We know there's a blessing. When there is no blessing, right? It's coming from Robert, or from the laws of Scotland. You people to be married by such freedom.
Thank you. Brigadoon. And tis the end of all of us. The miracle is over.
Thank you. Thank you.
Hey, you're pulling my bonny leg, aren't you?
No. I've never been more serious in my life. I tell you, Jeff, in one day, I feel more a part of her and all this than I ever felt about Jane or anybody or anything back home.
Tommy, that's because this is one day. You realize that if you stay here, it's for always?
Right.
You know how long always is around here?
Right.
Tommy, this can't be a trial marriage, because you can't change your mind after 600 or 700 years.
I won't ever want to.
You're absolutely certain you'll never miss your family, your friends, the way of life you belong to? How can you know that now?
Because, and here's where I know you'll think I'm crazy. Because I believe in her. And what's more, I believe in this place.
No, you don't. You just want to, Tommy. That's the way a dream is.
What do you mean, a dream?
Well, that's what this is, a dream.
What are you talking
it's
about?
It's a dream! Hello. You saw that funeral, didn't you?
Of course I did. Why?
Well, I'm responsible for it.
What do you mean? You
carried me? I killed it.
You did what?
I killed it, Tommy. Accidentally, of course, but nevertheless, I killed it. Out in the forest tonight, I suddenly saw him rushing past me from behind some rocks. Not even thinking about it, I stuck out my foot. Down he went. And then his head hit a rock with a nasty thud. And you know something, Tom? I don't feel a thing.
You actually don't feel anything?
Nothing. Except my going home.
Why don't you?
Because, Tommy, I haven't woken up yet. This is a dream. A good one for you and a bad one for me.
No, Tommy!
That Highland voodoo town makes no more sense to you than it does to me. So how can you believe in it when you don't understand it? When you leave here, that is when you wake up, you'll forget all about it. All right, maybe you'll be sorry you woke up for a few minutes, but that's just the other side of dealing with a nightmare, Tommy. When you say to yourself in the middle of it, God, I'm glad when I wake up and find out that this is just a dream. Confusing?
Yeah.
Well, think about this in your confusion, Tommy. If you wake up in a couple of 100 years and decide that you want to get out, the only way you can do it is Harry Beaton. By destroying an entire building. Don't forget. That would include me all.
Fiona tells me you want to stay.
Tommy, what is it?
No good, Fiona, I'm leaving. Not because I don't love you, I think I do.
You mean you're not sure?
You better hurry, Fiona. There's not much time left. Didn't it feel ashamed of yourself? Hardest thing in the world to give everything. Though usually it is the only way to get everything. Do you understand it all?
Thank you.
shouldn't be sorry about anything.
Thank you. Sorry, it's not your fault. Something happened a few months ago, I can't explain, and now I don't get it anymore.
Well, I think you're going clean out of your mind. And if you think anyone else is going to put up with your nonsense, you're breaking it bad. So think about that, Mr. Albright, when you're all alone.
Anything is possible, even miracles.